Hi everyone, I'm Barkha Dutt and you're with The Mojo Story, our independent digital platform that does a deep dive into the big stories of the day. On the program today, the arrest of 22-year-old climate change activist Disha Ravi, picked up from Bangalore, brought to Delhi and in police custody for 5 days. One in what is a series of crackdowns by the police. Non-bailable warrants have been issued for two other climate change activists, Nikita Jacob and Shantanu among them. The police has gone on record to say that Disha is among those who conspired, according to the police, with the pro-Khalistani group based out of Canada. In other words, she will now be facing sedition charges for having, in her own words, edited two lines in what's come to be known as Greta Thunberg's toolkit. What is this toolkit? It's essentially an advocacy docket with a list of briefing notes, hashtags, Twitter handles to tag, how to basically amplify your message online. How do we read this crackdown, this arrest? A lot of focus has been placed on Disha's age, leading to now a huge national and political debate as to whether the police is really pursuing justice or seeking to divert attention from the farmers' protest by picking on soft targets. Let's introduce our panel today. We have a full house and I'm going to introduce everybody one by one. Let me start by welcoming to the program Jasmine Pateja. Jasmine Pateja is a Bangalore-based activist. Welcome to the program. Let me also welcome to the program Shreya Singhal, who's a well-known lawyer and most famously was at the forefront of the 69A petition, which was when, by the way, the UPA was in power. We're joined by Sushant Sareen, who's an analyst and commentator with the Observer Research Foundation. Welcome, Sushant. We also have Neeraj Kumar, former police commissioner of Delhi, with a critical role now being sort of, you know, questioned around whether the police is acting in the interest of justice or not. Mr. Kumar's comments will become very, very important. Tavleen Singh, one of our most acerbic and, in my view, bravest columnists and journalists, is with us. And pleasure is always, Tavleen, to have you. And we're also joined by Yuvan. Yuvan works with a group called Fridays for Future. This was the movement that Disha was associated with, the climate change and environmental activist movement. So welcome everybody to the program. And let me start with you, Tavleen, if I can. You know, the point is that now we're talking about everything but the farmers' protests. We're now looking at these pictures of young Disha. She's been associated with this movement, but the allegation really against her is sedition. The allegation is that she conspired with this, you know, Poetic Justice Foundation out of Canada that is pro-Khalistan, which it may well be. But the toolkit, of course, is being made to sound like a box of AK-47s, right? Not an online docket. What is your take?
I actually saw the Khalistan movement when it was at its height, which was after Bhindranwale was killed in 84 and after the Sikhs were killed in Delhi. And there was then a certain sympathy in Punjab for the Khalistan movement. And at that point, it was a danger. But they didn't have groups called Poetic Justice for the Sikhs or Sikhs for Justice, etc. It was a serious movement. At the moment, it has no relevance because it has no support at all in Punjab. And that is what is important. So it to me, it's a bogey that they're raising for no reason whatsoever, except maybe to malign the Sikh farmers that are protesting. The other thing I would like to say is that, you know, the charges they're making against her of sedition is talking to Greta Thunberg or talking to this Poetic Justice, whatever, you know, comedy show. Is that sedition? And are we afraid of, I mean, you know, I think that everyone must be laughing at the idea that Greta Thunberg should be considered such a threat to India. I mean, she is a threat to those who would damage the environment. That's her only cause. So secondly, if somebody uploads this bizarre little toolkit or whatever, that's a threat to India. If it is, we need to be really worried about whether they've allowed security, the security of this country, to go down the tube.
So, which, you know, your argument is that even if this Poetic Justice Foundation is pro-Khalistani, and by the way, police officials have pointed to a video filmed outside the police claims, one of our consulates in Canada, where Dhaliwal is reported to be speaking in favor of Khalistan and saying Khalistan is an idea and this protest won't just end with the farmers' movement. You're saying whether he is pro-Khalistan or not doesn't matter when it comes to the targeting of a young woman.
He's in Canada. Are they making Khalistan in Canada? Khalistan is only important if there is support for this ridiculous idea in Punjab, and there is none. I say that as a good, proud Jat Sikh, there is none. There was at one point when the Sikhs were massacred in Delhi, when the Golden Temple was, you know, the army went in. That was a very bad time. And it was backed by Pakistan then. I'm sure that they're trying to revive it, but it has no support in Punjab, and that is what matters.
Why do you think they're targeting Disha? Before I open it up, Tavleen, why do you think they're targeting Disha? Now, none of us know her personally, but, you know, and some people have said, why are you focusing on her age? There are BJP members of parliament who've said Burhan Wani and Ajmal Kasab were younger than her when they did what they did. So what's her age got to do with it?
They were terrorists. Burhan Wani, his whole movement was to make Kashmir into an independent Islamic Republic. This girl, as far as I know, is a climate activist. You know, we're not talking, it's not just about her age. I felt awful to see this happen because, you know, I'm very proud of being Indian and being confident that our security forces, we have the fourth largest army in the world. We have highly trained commandos, paramilitary, and we're worried about a little girl in Bangalore.
Neeraj Kumar, this is going to come back to the police, right? This is going to come back to the role of the police. Had you been serving commissioner today, would you have taken this route? Would you have taken this route where the most dangerous person in India, supposedly, is this 22-year-old Disha, about whom, at least basis of what we know in the public domain, the most extreme thing that you can say is that she's a radical, that perhaps she sort of got involved in a movement with groups that she did not know fully the background of. Does that make her seditious? Does that make her dangerous? Does that make her a terrorist who should be compared to Burhan Wani and Ajmal Kasab? What is making the police take this route very aggressively, very stridently? And, you know, I just want to point out to you, not to make this at all about myself, but in parallel, there is a video across platforms that has called for the hanging of journalists, including myself. I have tagged the Delhi police multiple times asking for action against the people who made this video. This video has been defended by certain ruling party functionaries as well, certain, not all, and quite lower down the ranks. And we've seen no action where there's an actual hanging called for, but there's this young kid whom we have no reason to believe she's dangerous, yet she's been presented as a terrorist, Mr. Kumar.
Barka, first of all, let's keep the individual and her age and her background and what she does otherwise aside. Let us see what has actually happened. What has happened is that a certain document called Toolkit has been in circulation, which provides a template in which any movement or any agitation can find the sort of bearings, and it can use the template to further its cause. Now, nobody is saying that Disha Ravi is a terrorist. Nobody is saying that she is comparable to Burhan Wani or Ajmal Kasab or this one or that one. Nobody is saying that. The basic point is that what is the action that she has taken? What are her activities which have attracted penal action against her, which have attracted the arrest and so on? First of all, I don't know all the facts, but from whatever little I have come to know through the press conference that the Delhi police addressed just a few minutes back, she formed a WhatsApp group in which she, Shantanu and Nikita to begin with were members, and they formulated a certain software or parts of a software which became a part of the larger toolkit within inverted commas, which was then circulated amongst people and amongst the agitating farmers. Mm-hmm. Now, let us not get emotional about these things that, well, she's not a terrorist, she's not a Khalistani, Khalistan is a dead movement, etc. Nobody is saying that Khalistan is an active movement of today. Nobody is saying that. The point remains that there have been attempts in the recent past by our enemies, namely Pakistan, namely the ISI, to revive Khalistan.
So let's go and get them. Let's go and get these Pakistanis. Khalistanis.
I wish we could get hold of Dawood Ibrahim and Tiger Memon, who I kept pursuing for the better part of my life. Because you cannot reach them. You just cannot reach them. It's an enemy country. I can share you on this platform that at one point we had planned such an operation to reach the guy, which was, eventually...
Fair enough. Yeah. Let me just ask you this. Could the police not have simply questioned her at her house? Instead of why do you need this person in custody? I think what I'm not understanding, let's say... For a moment, because there's certain gaps in information. For example, we don't know how Disha got involved with this Poetic Justice Foundation in Canada, who sent the link, what the correspondence was. There are gaps in this information. So let's say she got involved with the wrong people unknowingly. She's a young woman in her 20s. She has no sort of record of terrorist activity, right? We all seem to agree on that at least. Mr. Kumar, could she not have just been questioned at her home? What is the need for this girl to need police custody and for the police to ask for it?
There, I would agree with you. There are two options. You can make somebody an accused and not arrest that person and question her at her residence or in a place that is convenient to her. Yeah. Or the other option is that you do what is called the custodial interrogation. And the investigating officer or the team which is investigating the case, they thought that they are better served, the investigation is better served with her in custody, and the custodial interrogation is what is in order. So that decision is that of the investigating agency.
But you believe, sir, the police has behaved proportionately.
You and I are nobody to sit in judgment over what has been done. The person who has to sit in judgment is the magistrate before whom she was produced. That magistrate would have easily castigated the police.
I can see Shreya wanted to come in, but I just want to just bring in Sushant briefly, and Shreya, I'll come to you in just a minute. Because Sushant, yours was among the comments online that said that the age was a non-issue, that so many of us, our first response was to notice the age of this. I can't help but calling her a girl. I don't mean that in a patronizing way, but I'm 49 years old and I remember when I was 21. And so therefore, intuitively, without meaning any disrespect or paternalism, I say girl, young woman. You're saying the age is a non-factor, right? But I think the age comes into it because what people are seeing are these photographs, and we can just bring them up again, of maybe some young radical in Bangalore running a climate change campaign, a cleanup campaign, part of some WhatsApp group, perhaps did not know what this Thaliwal of Poetic Justice Foundation pro-Khalistani group, as the police has now revealed details, is. But does she need to be in police custody, and does her age not leap out at you as well, Sushant?
Okay, Barkha, I think it's important for me to clarify one thing out here. One, that I do not agree with this goddamn business of demanding that everybody that you don't agree with or everybody whose views you don't like, you demand that they be thrown into jail. I'm sorry, I don't agree with that. I believe, people should be able to ignore people's views which they don't agree with. Okay, and that includes people like you, who's hanging is being demanded. I think that that's certainly not on. And so I'm not one of those who demands that everybody whose views I don't like, and there are many issues on which I don't agree with you, I will not demand that you be thrown into jail because of that. So I think that's where I'm coming from. Secondly, this whole focus on the age of a person, and I wonder if it has something to do with that she's a person like us, you know, she's people like us. And so there is a natural affinity that people like us have for somebody like that. And we think, look, okay, fine, she's a radical, she's done something, maybe she's done something stupid, maybe she got involved with the wrong guys. Until and unless she's a minor, if she's a major, and if she's done something stupid, advertently, inadvertently, I don't know. That's for the police to or the courts to decide. But frankly, had what happened on 26 Jan not happened, do you think anybody would have even bothered about what her views are? She would have just been another one of those characters, you know, who screams and shouts by the time she reaches 30. She would have understood how the world works and come back to normal. You know, a lot of us during college have gone through that phase. So there is nothing extraordinary about somebody becoming a major activist and then piping down once you have a family, you have a kid, you have a job to keep, all of that. So, but my point is that if she gets involved with somebody, and I'm afraid I don't entirely agree with Tavleen when she says that there's absolutely nothing happening in Punjab, there is no Khalistan movement. Yes, it is certainly not of the level it was when she was in active journalism and reporting from there, and very intrepidly, I might add. But surely there are issues which have been coming up over the last 6, 7, 8 years. And we've seen that there have been target killings. There have been all sorts of other activity to try and ignite this movement. And we also know that regardless of how you think about the farmers' movement, whether you agree, you do not agree with them, there is an effort to insert some of these characters into that movement. Now, should this girl not have done due diligence before getting involved? And just one or two points more. Look, you know, we can say that, listen, why are we tilting at the mid-wheels? It's just a tweet. Why did the Americans ban Donald Trump? Why did they go after all those people who went into the Capitol building? Because democracy is a fragile institution. You have to protect it. And people, if you hobnob with somebody, for example, you had that Shami witness. You remember that guy? Nobody even talks about him anymore. What was he doing? He was just tweeting stuff, right? He didn't kill anybody. He didn't murder anybody. He was just a young tech who was taken in by the ISIS. Now, how either you decide what is kosher and what is not kosher, I don't have a problem with it. But if supposing there is something which has happened on 26 Jan and very clearly there was a call for violence or violent protests, in that particular toolkit, which incidentally is not a four-letter word. A lot of activists use something called a toolkit to mobilize themselves, and most of it for bona fide reasons. But if it is not bona fide, and if something like this erupts into violence, should we just simply turn a blind eye and say, okay fine, a person like us, let's forget about it?
I want to say a couple of things to what you said, and a brief interjection from Tavleen, and then I'll go to come to you, Shreya. One, you know, it was this program, this platform, that first exposed the fact that there were Khalistani sympathizers like Deep Sidhu in the middle of the movement. That was my interview, much to the ire of many of my friends on the left who thought I was demeaning the farmers' movement. I was not. I believe the farmers' protest, Sushant, had all kinds of people. It did not have a singular person at its head. And just because there were the Deep Sidhus floating in its midst does not mean that the bulk of the farmers were not proud, patriotic Indians carrying the Tiranga and making their point peacefully for over 2 months. So we have to be able to recognize that many things can be simultaneously true, and broad strokes are a huge disservice to people. Secondly, you said that, you know, just because you disagree with me on something, you won't call for my hanging. Thank you. But the point is that the folks who do call for the hanging of people like me are still functional on Twitter. There's no police case against them. And there's an actual, I'm just making the point of the irony of what's actually unfolding here. And what happens is there's a lot of bullshit, a lot of defamatory lies are bunched around about people. And in this age, it's very difficult for the audience to know what's true, what's not true. And Tavleen, a brief interjection there, because the police in its press conference says that Disha was, and along with the other two, Nikita and Shantanu, was part of a WhatsApp group, that she is the one who urged Greta Thunberg to delete the original toolkit, which called for a day of global protest on India's Republic Day. That's when Greta Thunberg puts up a new toolkit and so on. And therefore, maybe she's young, maybe she's not a terrorist, but she got involved with people who are pro-Khalistani. Not Greta, but this poet, this Dhaliwal character. Tavleen?
I want to, one, Sushant is absolutely right that democracy is a fragile thing, but it becomes more fragile when dissent is crushed by arresting a child and throwing her into jail for 5 days for custodial interrogation. Everybody on this panel knows what that means, right? This is, you're making it more fragile. The minute that you are worried by something as small as this, you make democracy more fragile. Democracy, the heart blood of democracy, is protest, is, you know, and I'm very sorry to say this, but the Prime Minister himself made a comment in Assam, which, you know, which I investigated. He said that they're threatening yoga and they're threatening the tea estates. This turned out to be not true. The poetic, whatever they are, said we've got to change this image. That's their view. They want to change that image of India because they want to show that the farmers have been repressed, that nobody's listening to them. But, you know, democracy is much more fragile when you arrest children and put them into jail for 5 days for custodial interrogation.
Yeah, I think that's a fair point, and I would agree with that. I cannot think of one reason. I just want to share my honest opinion on this. I don't know anything else, but I can't think of one reason, Sushant, that this girl could not have been questioned at her house. I don't get it. Where was she going to go? What was she going to do? Like, was she going to cross the border into Pakistan? Was she going to mobilize weapons? I mean, I do not understand why we have to have such a tough police state attitude. And I will ask Mr. Kumar about that, but I just want to get Shreya, because Shreya, the point that Neeraj Kumar would then make is that the magistrate decided to do this, and the magistrate could have said no. The magistrate could have said that there's no need for police custody. Go ahead, Shreya.
I think the magistrate ought to have said that, and I think it was also the responsibility of the IO to have some, you know, issue a 41A notice, ask her to join investigation. Custodial interrogation is left as an option when a person refuses to join investigation. You could have issued a notice under section 90 of the CRP, 91-92, asking for her mobile phone, asking for everything, to the details of her digital footprint. You could have asked her under section 160 of the CRPC. None of that is done. Instead, you come, suddenly take her away, a 21-year-old. I remember when I was 21, I had no clue what I was getting into. And that may not be that's not something to justify anything. But at the end of the day, a climate activist tweeting about a toolkit, that is, the government doesn't like something, so they just instantaneously will take very excessive action. And unfortunately, Disha in this situation has become a soft target. She's the easy target. You know, you take the easy targets and you use those easy targets to show everyone else, listen, you better fall in line, otherwise this is what will happen to you. That's exactly what was done in Bhima Koregaon to a large extent. They are, and all of them are still in jail 2 years later. There's no charge sheet filed. Their bails are being denied on a daily basis from literally the magistrate up to the Supreme Court. Now you will turn this into a second Bhima Koregaon where you will start involving and arresting people who have no means, no wherewithal to be able to defend themselves in a political conspiracy that the state is doing, is hatching literally against its own citizenry. It is not that the farmers' protest is a pro-Khalistan movement. You will always have fringe elements in every protest. Look at the RSS. The RSS was banned till about 20 years ago in this country. The RSS was considered a fringe element of the BJP and the VHP. So you can't just hide behind this. Everyone is a pro-Khalistani. Everyone is a terrorist. That way, what is the point? We are a police state today. Democracy is dead.
Sushant, you wanted a brief interjection there?
Just a very brief one. See, my point is that, look, here is this girl who's supposed to be an activist. No quibbles with that. She probably has done activism for a number of years. How many times was she hauled up by the police or by the state or was targeted.
Her movement has faced a previous charge, but again, when she was protesting against, an environmental legislation that she didn't agree with. And we'll have the details
of that. I'm not aware of that particular incident, and I don't know what kind of a protest it was. Let me
read it out to you.
The thing I'm trying to say is a very simple thing that would anybody have gone after her toolkit or no toolkit if there had not been the kind of scenes we witnessed on 26th of January?
But she didn't break the barricades.
She might not have broken the barricades, but she didn't put up the Nishan Sahib at Red Fort. What she is being accused of being part of the people who orchestrated that thing, rightly or wrongly, that is what she's being accused of. That is what the allegation against her is. And that is what she's going to be tried on or she's going to be hauled up for. Now, whether that is right or wrong, I'm in no position to judge that. On your other question, should she have been, arrested in the first instance? Maybe not. I don't know. I think either the lawyers out here or the police officer out here is in a better position to say whether, the arrest was required or maybe she had been investigated.
I've got Yuvan and Jasmine waiting to speak. I just want to briefly give context here. On the 22nd of July in 2020, Fridays for Future, that's the movement that Yuvan belongs to and Disha was with as well, sent a representation to the Delhi police seeking restoration of its website, which was blocked for encouraging public participation in the consultation for the draft EIA notification, right? So this was another environment-related legislation. In its representation, Friday Futures clarified that it merely provided a template for citizens to submit their objections, and the emails were actually sent from the personal emails, etc. Now, the reason I'm bringing this up is that they have actually locked horns with the Delhi police before, and that was in the context of another sort of protest movement, which I'm sure Yuvan can tell us a little bit more about. But Shreya, very quickly, then Jasmine and Yuvan. Yeah. Shreya, you wanted to say something to Shreya?
Yeah, I actually wanted to say that, 1 year ago, literally 1 year ago, Delhi was burning. But what action has been taken against Anurag Thakur or Mr. Mishra? They're still out there. They're still tweeting the same types of venom that caused Delhi to burn. No action is taken against them because they have political patronage and the umbrella of the political party. But you will go after, viciously go after young women and young men who are trying to exercise their democratic right of speech, of expression, of peaceful protest, and without attributing anything. She's sitting in Bangalore. I'm sorry, international flights are banned. Where is she going to run away that you can't have questioned her over VC? You can't have created your own mechanism to deal with this. And what happened on 26th of January was almost a month ago. So what is the urgency that you have come to Bangalore, arrested this poor girl in Bangalore and have got her back to Delhi? Where heavens are not falling.
Yeah. Let me just bring in Jasmine and then Yuvan, and I'll go to Mr. Kumar right after that. Jasmine, you're an activist. You're based out of Bangalore, the same city where Disha is picked up, brought to Delhi. Shreya believes that this is a message to all activists, within the boundary or else. But there are others who believe that when you are an activist, you heard what Sushant said, it's your job to do due diligence. Now, I'm actually a bit scared about these WhatsApp groups because I'm added to one almost every day. Sometimes I have time to relieve myself from them. Mostly, I don't read the WhatsApp groups I'm in. Technology makes it possible, by the way, for anybody to be added to a WhatsApp group. I can block it. But I actually need time and focus to even do that. And sometimes I don't have time to do that. But in this case, the police is alleging that she actually deleted or altered, deleted some WhatsApp groups, etc. What's the word in Bangalore? What's the mood on the street in Bangalore?
I think I want to take a minute or less to just respond to the narrative here, where there is, Disha as a young child or, somebody who's much younger, may not know, may be mellowed as she gets into her 30s. So I'm responding to that. I would urge us to...
That's why I clarified that it didn't come from a place of any sort of patronizing paternalism. But the fact is, when it's someone so young, her age will be noticed. It would have been even if it were a boy. So this isn't a sexist patronizing thing, but go ahead.
Yeah, but I urge us to see her as one of the many youth in this country who are looking at the farmers' protest in the country and trying to devise ways to stand in solidarity. And I would like to replace the word toolkit with a megaphone. If you're on site and you need and people need to know what to do next or how can they stand in solidarity in very peaceful ways, they will hold a megaphone. The same way the toolkit for anyone who's gone through it will see that it just says use this hashtag, tag the stakeholders in the tweets. It's simple, peaceful organizing, but it just enables everyone to stand in solidarity. So, and as somebody who's gone through the toolkit today, I don't see anything that could lead to anything volatile. It is peaceful. It's an act of claiming your citizenship, enabling others to claim your citizenship, exercising your rights in a country that is meant to be democratic, and really stepping into that. As far as the WhatsApp group is concerned, I don't have too many details of the WhatsApp group, and I don't know Disha personally, but I've had a chance to speak to some people who do know her, and they tell me that she's somebody who cares deeply about the planet, who cares deeply about her community, and who cares deeply about her country. And that's what I'm bringing in here. There's a personhood. She's not somebody who's going to, she's a person. She's the youth of this country. She's a part of this youth. She may be a little like us, and it may be another person who's not like us, but we have to listen to how the youth are responding to the farmers' protest. And this is a democratic country. One of the questions asked in one of the calls to action in that document, in that toolkit, is ask India why. And it's our fundamental right to be able to ask why, to be able to question. And that's being silenced right now. And that's
I just mean to ask Yuvan to explain some of the missing gaps and maybe he can help us. But the charge against her is not to be technically correct, is not that she questioned the farmers' protests or the farm legislations, but that she conspired with a separatist insurgent group based out of Canada. That is the charge. And that is where things get hazy because we actually just don't have any information on how this Poetic Justice Foundation, whatever the hell it is, got involved in this. But this was such a massive movement. It's like when I go to the farmers' protest, Sushant, I just want to share a little thought I had this morning. You know, there were people who would like get photographs taken. We would sometimes take photographs. Now tomorrow, some guy there could turn out to be some Khalistani, I don't know. I didn't even know who Deep Sidhu was till I interviewed him. I had no idea who the man was. I discovered it in the interview and then I, you know, hastily disowned him. He could have been arrested months before he was and months before he got to the Red Fort. But just mean that's the charge, not a right to protest the farmers, the farm laws, right? You want to quickly say something on that?
No, but thank you for clarifying that. And you had a question also with regards to the WhatsApp groups. And
no, my point is that the charge against her is that if she is an adult, as you want us to treat her as a young adult, then the corollary to that might be a Sushant or a Neeraj Kumar or others, even on our live stream, saying she should have known who she was hanging with. She should have known who she was talking to. She should have known that this guy, you know, if she was corresponding with him on a WhatsApp group, Dhaliwal, is a Khalistani or a Khalistani Khalistan sympathizer, as the police says he is. So that's where I think that's where the police is building a case. Yuvan, maybe as someone who works in the same movement as Disha, who knows her, you can explain to us what happened, how this group actually came into contact with you guys. You know, what was the whole story? How did she come to a point where she edited two lines, as she has said in court? This is this Poetic Justice Foundation. Go ahead, Yuvan. Yuvan?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Right now, am I audible? Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, you are. Yes. Yes,
yeah, okay.
Yes,
I just
yes.
want to give an inside story. So I'm a volunteer with Fridays for Future India, and Disha is a friend. And I think it's important to debunk this entire toolkit myth, because a lot of youth networks were part of creating this. It was something very simple. It was making the legalese of the farm laws accessible to people and putting down some links from various newspapers, magazines, etc., which have covered this so that people can read about it in simple terms. And then if public wanted to give solidarity, what all they could do. Yeah. And this was all it was. And there were all kinds of toolkits which were going out. This toolkit was shared by Greta Thunberg, and it created a storm with the people in power. And We are seeing this as a retaliation, as a way to say, if you speak up and if it makes enough noise, you will be silenced. Yeah, and Fridays for Future is, as many other youth networks, has school children, has, you know, college students, a lot of young people are doing beach cleanups and afforestation programs, you know, lake cleanups. You know, what is the message you're giving these people? You know, that's what a lot of other eminent people are asking. And I think Disha herself, she's a, I just want to mention that she's recently been working with, along with a lot of others, something called the MAPA movement, you know, most affected people and areas due to the climate change. So that includes farmers, fisher folk, Adivasi people, poor people, yeah, and bringing this into center stage and international dialogues. And she's been successful in doing that. And then it's quite strategic to hit her so that this whole movement and youth network kind of collapses. Yeah.
So thank you, because most of Disha's friends have been too scared actually to come out and speak. And Sushant, I'll come to why you disagree. But what I want to understand from you is, if you do know, because I'm not trying to make you answerable, and you know I'm not the cops, but the police alleges that there was some Canada-based woman called Puneet who put Disha, Nikita, others in touch with this Poetic Justice Foundation. The police says that the Poetic Justice Foundation is a pro-Khalistan group. There is a video that has been filmed, the police says, outside the consulate, Indian consulate, where this man is, according to the police, openly talking about how his support will not end with the farm protest. Can you, Yuvan, if you know, tell us,
Absolutely.
If what the connection is between Disha and these pro-Khalistan group, as the police describes it.
Yeah. With Disha, with the youth movements, Fridays for Future India, there's absolutely no connection with pro-Khalistani groups. In fact, it's the Delhi police which first said it, and we even heard the word. We put a list of links in the toolkit which explain the farm laws. One happened to be by Poetic Justice, was a lack of research, and it went up there. And that was hooked on, and it was made into this story of Khalistani. I completely vouch for this, because I've been inside there watching what's going on.
Can you explain that properly? So you're saying that the toolkit was prepared by all of you, not by the Poetic Justice Foundation.
Not at all.
In the links, in the online links that you shared in this toolkit, one link was of that of the Poetic Justice Foundation. It was an absence of research.
Absolutely. That's what I'm saying.
You didn't do a background check on them, and that is it.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, that's exactly what happened.
And there was no direct communication between the Poetic Justice Foundation and Disha and all of you?
No.
This edited.
We absolutely don't know these people.
Yeah. Greta Thunberg originally, Yuvan.
And the editing, yes, it did happen. Yes.
Can you explain? Yeah.
Sorry, I lost you there. Can you just...
Can you explain the editing and why Disha has been accused of telling Greta to take down the first toolkit and put up the second one? And I am not policing you, but I think you must have a chance. You must have the chance to address these things that are being leveled against all of you.
Yeah. So Disha has been the face of FFF India at an international stage. So she has raised the farmers' protests, the EIA, other kinds of environmental and social crisis in international platforms. And that's all there is to it. And there's the core team and members who meet in an international way and have access to people like Greta and other celebrities who can amplify causes local movements are fighting for.
Okay.
So first it was on Google, which is a far more kind of open and editable. It was made into CryptPad, into a different form, correcting some of the, making it more precise and stuff. But linking it to Khalistani is a completely attention diversion tactic, because we didn't know this organization was with them, nor did we know this word existed. you know, it was tweeting about, you know, Delhi putting out tweets, and what they were saying is that, oh, okay, this is what they're talking about. This is absolutely what happened.
Yeah. How old are you, if I may ask? How old are most people in the movement? How is it a very young movement? Is it essentially young people?
We have school children from 12-year-olds.
Yeah.
You know, just to most of our volunteers are between 12 and 18.
Yeah. So I just want to take this to Neeraj Kumar. You want to stay with us. Thank you for that. Mr. Kumar, in this profession of journalism, there has been poor research. There have been wrong maps. We've all made mistakes. You have this young man here saying, yeah, we should have researched who these guys are. I've sometimes come into programs without knowing my research in a hurry. It happens. Why is this woman being treated as a terrorist? I think that is the point. Why is she being treated as a terrorist? Could the police not have done this differently?
Now, why have you come to this conclusion, Barkha, that she's being treated as a terrorist?
Because I can't think of one reason she needs to be in custody. Please question her, but I can't think of one reason that she needs to be in custody. Please question her. I don't know her. I know nothing about her, but I see a 22-year-old, you know, radical perhaps, as we all were at that age. Maybe some ideas that she may or may not change. Jasmine will hate me for saying that. May or may not change. I have no idea. I just can't think of one reason that she should be in custody.
Now, I'll tell you. First of all, everyone who is in custody is not a terrorist, number one. Number two, another thing I wanted to clarify what you said about you become members, you know, you are made a member of various WhatsApp groups, and whenever you can, you delete. Now, here the WhatsApp group was created by Disha, if I know my facts correctly. This is what has been told to me by the one of the officers who is dealing with the case, that between her, Shantanu and Nikita, this group was created, and she was the WhatsApp group administrator. This is what I've been told. So it is not as if she was made a member accidentally. Now, coming to whether she's a terrorist or not, if she was a terrorist, then sections of, say, UAPA and so many other...
So she's been charged. The police says that she's guilty of disaffection against the Indian state. That's sedition.
She has been charged against sedition. If you read the bare text of sedition, 124A, whatever it is, then it says that anyone who tries to create disaffection against the government, which has been lawfully elected, then you come into the purview of that section. So, see, all these things...
Do you think she should be in custody, sir?
No. Do you
think her questioning was necessary?
Is
this a case for custodial interrogation?
Let me tell you, you asked me that question first, in the first round.
Yeah.
Maybe if I was in charge of the investigation, I would have said no. There's no need to take her into custody. Yeah. What you ought to do is that you question her, and if there's something... very pressing, which requires her to be brought to Delhi, and you summon her to Delhi, you question her and so on. I would have refrained at this stage from arresting her. So I do not know under what circumstances the police thought it was necessary to arrest her.
Yeah.
Today, Nikita and Shantanu, they are both reportedly absconding. They cannot be found as we speak. So I again say that it is the discretion of the investigating officer or the investigating team.
Let me get responses to that.
We cannot sit on judgment over their decisions.
But we can ask questions.
Yes, of course.
As long as we are a free country, we can ask questions. We may not be able to sit in judgment.
We can. Yeah. But legally, the person who was... who could have intervened and who could have said no was
the magistrate. I will get Shreya to talk about that. But I want Yuvan, very briefly, if you can hear me, to come in on this point. Was the WhatsApp group created by Disha, Nikita and Shantanu, or was it a collaboration of different youth networks? And was there any direct communication with this Poetic Justice Foundation chaps on this WhatsApp group, Yuvan? Yuvan, can you hear me? You need to unmute yourself, Yuvan. Yeah.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, go ahead.
Well, I'm sorry, I did not, I couldn't catch your question. I'm sorry.
The WhatsApp group that she's accused of having created, yeah. Was that created by her? And was there any direct conversation with these Poetic Justice Foundation chaps in it?
No. So this was a movement which was a collaboration with cross-sectional youth networks across India, which mm-hmm. is not kind of coordinated or spearheaded or, you know, directed in a certain way. We came together and said, what's happening in the country? The farmers' protests. Now let's find out how common people can understand what's happening and give this solidarity. And then WhatsApp was a way in which we coordinated together. It was a diffuse movement, decentralized, and it absolutely doesn't make sense why a single person is being targeted. Now,
but was there any, was the Poetic Justice Foundation people members
no,
of this WhatsApp?
No. So I know all the networks which were part of this, they were Indian, and I know, you know, all the people who were there, who were good people doing hard work, you know, trying okay. to raise awareness about environmental campaigns. You know, it started with the NBWL clearances during the lockdown, you know, 40 places in India, large clearances were given. And then we woke up and said it was complete, the, you know, right from Sharavati to Dibang Valley to Vedandangal in Tamil Nadu. Across India. So that was spearheaded by youth. People didn't okay. know what was happening. And I think
that yeah. is actually what has happened here. Diffused yeah. movement, not just on that WhatsApp group, Sushant, but also the nature of the farmers' movement, which is why there have been these kind of people who have been able to fish in troubled waters. But that doesn't mean that we use a sort of broad brush and we smear everybody. I want to get reactions on what we've heard so far. Tavleen, Sushant, Shreya, and then Jasmine. Tavleen, go ahead.
I wanted to actually pick up on two things that I heard, one from Sushant and the other from Shreya. Sushant has gone on and on about how it's the 26th January violence, etc. And Shreya made a very correct point, which is that there were riots in Delhi caused by very reckless BJP spokespeople, ministers saying, shoot the terrorists, etc. 50 people died. How is it that only people who speak against the government, only dissidents, are targeted? And it's not just poor Disha. It's we've seen a whole list of people who are in jail with charges that range from sedition to terrorism just because they disagree with the government. And Shreya makes a very good point. Where would she have gone? There are no flights to Canada from Bangalore at the moment, or from Bombay or wherever. And, you know, Sushant, why don't you explain, how is it that Anurag Thakur has not been questioned about that rally that he addressed where he whipped up a frenzy? How is it that other people who speak for the government and speak violently on social media are not also treated, accused of sedition? What has gone wrong, I believe, is that in the past 7 years, we've begun to associate the government with India. They are not the same thing. When yeah. you betray your country, that is terrorism, that is sedition. To criticize the government is healthy protest. It's what makes democracy survive. We are not Hong Kong.
Yeah. I do want to ask Sushant this, actually, Sushant. The conflation between the state and the government is a very, very dangerous conflation, right?
Of course it is. And of course, I believe that everybody has the right opposition. Without opposition, what kind of a democracy would it be? But, you know, my problem with when Tavleen raises the question, and the questions she raises are correct, but the questions are one-sided. How many times has Tavleen, for example, I think, okay, Kangana Ranaut is quite batty. Fine, accepted. Does she deserve to be tried for sedition? As we speak, she's undergoing charges of sedition. And why does
no? I think the law actually needs to be junked. I think the law of sedition needs to be junked.
So, Barkha, by the way, across the board, if you want my opinion. Here is the thing. Yeah. This kind of selectiveness, you know, this is what then pisses off other people. Why are you so silly? So Kangana Ranaut sedition, there is another character by the name of Samit Thakur. I think he spent, I don't know how many weeks in prison because he had criticized Uddhav Thackeray and his son. And he was subjected to torture, put into jail, all sorts of indignities were heaped upon him. How many people talked about it? Let's talk about, I can give you chapter and verse of people in Mumbai.
So can we agree that it's all wrong? Can we agree that it's all wrong?
Barkha, for God's sake, this is what I said right at the beginning. You know, this tendency that because I don't agree with you, you will put me in jail or you will slap a sedition charge.
Do you think this woman should be in jail? Do you think, Sushant, that Disha should be in jail?
Look, I didn't even know she existed. So her friend who out here was painting this grand conspiracy theory that the government is targeting her because it wants to go after all activists. I think that's a whole lot of crap. But I don't
think... So why is the government targeting her? Is it not the perfect diversion from the farmers' protest? Is it not the perfect diversion?
You think these kind of diversions work? I don't think so.
Yes,
and
because guess what? We're all debating toolkits instead of farmers.
No, so you can't debate farmers.
I spent 3 months debating farmers.
Barkha, you can't debate it for another 3 months as long as the farmer agitation lasts. The point is that to paint this kind of a grand conspiracy, I think that's crap, number one. Number two, I don't think this girl would have ever been arrested regardless of what she thinks of the farmers' movement, whether she knows what it is all about or not, or it's a one-sided criticism of it, a Pavlovian response. I don't know, and I don't even want to get into it. My point is a very simple one. Had she not been associated with that particular toolkit, which is now being blamed, rightly or wrongly or allegedly, whatever you want to call it, I'm not a lawyer. But because that is being blamed for kind of instigating the violence which happened on the 26th of January, that is why she has been apprehended. Should she have been done or not done? Again, I think I'll go along with what Mr. Neeraj Kumar was saying. Finally, on the Delhi, I think look at the Delhi riots and the people who have been booked in a much more holistic way than we are doing right now. And the fact of the matter remains, from what I have read about what has happened, there have been equal number of people from both communities who have been arrested for inciting and indulging in violence. So to paint it as though only one side has been involved in it, I think that's wrong. And finally, on Anurag Thakur or anybody else, I don't hold a brief for them. But to imagine that something which Kapil Mishra said actually ignited the violence, I think that's an exaggeration. That is not the way things happen.
Well,
growing up, before that, about 2 weeks before that, there was another riot in Silampur. Who ignited that one? And you remember people came all the way up to Rajghat and were indulging in arson and violence?
But Sushant, the question still remains that Kapil Mishra, who by the way was one of those who reshared the video that called for my hanging, his Goli Maro Salo Ko, and his many hate speeches that were recorded in court by Justice Muralidhar, no action against him at all. So, you know, Barkha,
in this country, hate speech is being done by everybody. Don't pick up selectively. Talk about hate speech and make sure that you talk about it in an unbiased manner across. Just yesterday, for example, we came across these tweets of this woman who works in one of, I think, Ghana or something. Look at the kind of tweets she has done on the Hindu faith. I'm a non-practicing person. I'm non-ritualistic. I'm almost an atheist. But, you know, you insult a community like this and then you think it's perfectly kosher and you're making fun of it. Somebody will hit back. Why do you do this? I wouldn't do it to Islam or to Christianity or to Judaism. Why would I want to insult somebody? So to think that you can do this and get away with it, I think you are barking up the wrong tree. That is not going to happen anymore.
I want to get in Shreya and then Jasmine. Shreya, please go ahead.
I have 2-3 comments to make. Yeah. Unfortunately, the law affords and provides every citizen with the presumption of innocence until proven guilty. What is happening just now is the assumption that you are guilty and you have to prove your innocence, not in a court of law, but in a court of the janta. And it is a khap panchayat, which is what is turning out to be, you know, ending up where people's rights, their liberties are being completely taken away. And unfortunately, all dissent is being labeled as hate speech, is being labeled as anti-national. The thing is that there is, and what Ms. Singh said very rightly, there is a difference between the post of the Prime Minister and who holds that post. I have the right, and it is a fundamental right which is constitutionally protected, to say that Mr. Modi is not doing a good job. Mr. Manmohan Singh did not do a good job. That does not make me anti-national. That is not seditious. And that is my right, so that I can be informed. At the end of the day, the government is in power at the pleasure of the people. It is not there for their own pleasure. Then what is the point of having an election process? You might as well scrap it. So the entire issue, and what is rightly been discussed here, is that the fringe elements of a pro-Khalistani movement, which may or may not be there, have overtaken what the real issue is, which is the farmer laws, which is the fact that where we get our food from, the people who grow our food are not being compensated.
Shreya, can you comment on what Mr. Kumar was trying to say again and again? And Sushant has also made that point, that in the end, the decision lay with the magistrate, and the magistrate somewhere. You see, if all that was in the docket, as Yuan has said, was a link to the Poetic Justice Foundation, that by no means, you know, unless the police is alleging a money trail, which even the police hasn't, right? Why would this magistrate send this young woman to 5 days in
because custody? You see how it's being presented. The police will present it in a very vociferous manner and portray this lady as a terrorist or as a flight risk, and that is why she required custodial interrogation. What that magistrate ought to have done was allow her advocate to appear. She argued her own case. She was, I'm sorry, but if you are picked up from your home.
Now, I think they've clarified that she did have legal defense. I was seeing Rebecca John's notings on this, and first it seemed she didn't have a defense. Now they say they did have a defense, but a kind of inactive legal defense that was provided.
The thing is that's the court craft, right? If you have your public prosecutor along with the IO presenting the information in a certain manner to the judge, and this, and the person there does not have proper representation. She was offered legal aid. She was not offered her own representation. And this matter could have then been adjourned for one day, right? For it to be heard. But, and imagine the mental space of someone who's been picked up, a 21-year-old has been picked up, and age is important here. She has been picked up. She's just graduated from college in all likelihood, picked up from her home in the middle of a pandemic, brought to Delhi, arrested, brought to Delhi. I would not have the mental space to try and fight my own case before a court. I would be scared out of my mind. You are to afford her that right. You are at the end of the day taking away her liberty.
And Jasmine, I think that's why age does leap out, right? Maybe it shouldn't, but it does sort of leap out. And anyway, age is not the point. I really think it's not the point, except to sort of think of this recently, sort of, you know, recent college graduate with stars in her eyes about changing the world. You can't escape the sort of youthfulness of this moment. You can't also think, I mean, I think parents across this country today are going to tell their children one of two things. Either go out and be strong enough to be who you want to, or bap yaar, don't go out, because you're going to end up in jail. And that would be a pity, because young people have to be allowed to even make mistakes.
Absolutely. I too am thinking that there will be two aspects to this. Either there will be a sense of silencing, or there will be a sense of, we know why we need to continue asking questions, why we need to continue dissenting. And I can't de-link, we can't, you know, I'm thinking of Nodeep Kaur, I'm thinking of Natasha Narwal, I'm thinking of all the political prisoners that, and we can't de-link this accusation, you know, from all of them, of being this terrorist. And this is the context within which we need to see this sudden arrest and in a pandemic. And it is a message to everyone to say, if you dissent, if you question, if you ask India why, and as Tavleen has also said, that India is not the government, it is larger than that, it is all of us, it is we the people. So it is that message, and that's what we need to commit to resisting and practice and access our citizenship with, and enable our youth of this country also to do the same.
As an activist today, would you look over your shoulder more. And what did you make of Yuvan's kind of honest admission that there was a little bit of homework that we missed? We missed a research point while doing that docket.
I think that movements as an activist and also an artist activist, so there's that identity. And the other is of the movement. The movement is big, it's large, it's not, and the movement must allow plurality. And by that, I mean that it's not possible to know every, you know, from the entire spectrum. And we must take into account that there is the middle path of the movement, and there's the fringe of the movement, and it's not, and in doing, you know, and Disha is practicing within, I don't know if she was taking into account the entire spectrum. So I can't comment on that right now, but as an artist activist, it is, it's kind of a sharp reminder that we must continue to devise and innovate new forms of protest and make ourselves heard and enable, you know, enable all of us to be heard in ways that are not seen as protests also perhaps.
Okay, I need to take last comments. I'll start with you, Yuvan. You did admit that research was missed in attaching that link. One missing piece of the puzzle does remain. Disha reached out directly, according to the police, to Greta Thunberg to take down the first toolkit and upload the second one. The first toolkit was all about the focus on Republic Day. And, you know, a day of global protest, etc. And then the police says that the second toolkit is a sanitized version of the first toolkit. Can you explain actually what happened here, how it happened? And please unmute yourself.
So we edited the toolkit to make it, you know.
Why did you edit it? Can you explain this editing bit? Why did you edit it?
Yeah, so after the 26th, I think, there were certain kinds of actions. It was about showing up with banners. It was about sending emails and so on. And after that event was over, it was a different kind of action. And so that was the editing which took place. There was nothing in the toolkit, if you have the earlier or the later version, which had hate speech or had anything, any instigating material or had any links with, Khalistani movements. So there was a toolkit, toolkits worked that way. You know, earlier when there was the EIA 2006 or CRZ 2011, the government puts out a ready reckoner because lay people do not understand what is written there and then tells you who to reach out to, where to send your questions. So this toolkit evolved to different events to cater to those campaigns and those occasions.
And according to you, the one mistake that you guys made was to put the link of this Poetic Justice Foundation because you hadn't done your homework on it.
It was along with a set of other links. There was, you know, news from Indian Express, the Hindu, you know, Quinn, and there was this other link. That was the only link as such, which has been hooked on.
You are Disha's friend. What do you think she's going through right now? You know her family, you know her, you know the larger movement. What are her friends feeling? How are you guys holding it together? And what are you planning to do?
Yeah, I think the extraordinary trauma that she would be going through, you know, she might be very, very passionate about her cause. She has family, and then she has other, various other commitments along with which she's doing.
Okay, I can't hear you. You're going to have to fix your line, and I'll ask you the same question again. Sorry, Yuvan, I can't hear you. I'm going to get you back when your line's better. Let me take last comments. I'll start with you, Mr. Kumar. I'm hoping you can hear me. We've been losing you quite a bit as well. What do you think the police ought to be doing right now? I, for starters, would, as a citizen, like to know a lot more than the police has put in the public domain. If there is indeed such a strong case against these young people, please tell us more.
See, primarily, they will be going through the digital footprints and the digital backward and forward linkages that she has with various people who are alleged to have been instigating what happened at the Red Fort on 26th January. So basically, the evidence that will emerge against her would be digital evidence, and I'm sure the police will be able to link her to the crime or link her to the larger conspiracy that took place to the unfortunate events that took place on the 26th of January at the Red Fort.
Are you comfortable, Mr. Kumar, with the way this is unfolding? Are you comfortable as a former police commissioner?
No, as I said, I can have my views. But my views today are uninformed views in the sense that I don't have the overall picture. What is the evidence that has come on record? What is the, you know, what has compelled the police to do all this? As an individual, I could have gone slower. I would have said, let's get her over to Delhi by issuing a summon, etc., interview her without arresting her, etc. But there must have been something compelling to precipitate the kind of action that has been taken.
Okay. Yuvan, I'll let you complete your point. You were wanting to say something about Disha at this point. Yes.
Yes, I'm sorry. So the only compelling point to pull up this toolkit and not several others which were created by different groups was that Greta had shared this, an extraordinary, gave it extraordinary amplification. And then there was immediately a retaliatory move where all kinds of celebrities tweeted the self-same thing about, you know, coming to an amicable solution, you know. Having said that, I think, you know, speaking as somebody who knew Disha, and, you know, she might be passionate about environment, and she's been, you know, very, very pivotal in putting people together and you know, strengthening, you know, local voices. I think she would be going through trauma. She's sitting alone in Delhi, the kind of place it is right now. As a fact, I know that this episode has scared youth networks, you know, children and college students, who a whole lot of them are backed out, you know.
From the movement, from your campaign movement. Have you had parents? Have you had parents calling up and pulling out their kids from the movement? Jasmine, that's going to happen a lot now, isn't it?
Yeah, but also this is, I see this as almost like a immediate response. It is when, you know, in this fire, you step away and then you prepare yourself again to again claim your citizenship. So you are, you know, there is fear, and this is what it's intended to do, and that's what it is doing. But so that's what it's intending to do, and that's what it is doing. It has been doing to activists, and that's why we have so many political prisoners right now. But again, it just calls for, you know, reimagining citizenship, reimagining claiming our rights, reimagining interventions, reimagining dialogue, and stepping in with that, because change is what we need, change is what we want. The farmers are protesting for a reason, and we have to find ways of standing in solidarity and build ways of standing in solidarity. So really, re-examining the word solidarity too, and how, whether it's armchair or on the streets or at the Sindhu border.
I just wonder whether this is the beginning only, Shreya. I don't think it can end this story with three people called Shantanu, Nikita, and Disha. And that is why I keep coming back to a video that has called for the hanging of journalists. I will not be surprised if all of us are the next targets, and I don't say this in any sort of paranoid way at all, but, you know, you have this video which basically says that any handle in that toolkit that was named as the handles of journalists covering the farmers' protests are journalists who should be hanged. Yeah. So this is where we've reached in this conversation, and tomorrow the police could turn around and say, hey, you guys are also linked to these Khalistanis. I mean, there's no end to this, right, Shreya?
There isn't, and unfortunately, you know, the way our story, the story of India is going, we are in the middle of an emergency. Our democracy is directly under threat by the government, from the government, and that's what's happening. We, you know, they want to completely stifle this any kind of dissent, any kind of criticism. And, you know, a government, a mature government from one of the big, from the biggest democracy in the world, 70 years we have been independent, and yet we are not independent. We are confined and shackled by a government who is not willing to listen sideways and is only propagating its own narrative. And this is this coming from people who protested what happened, who were arrested, many of whom were arrested during the 1975 emergency. I mean, you know, you are what you have done is you are, it's an endless cycle then. You're no better than the person who you are, who you have been gaining political capital out of.
Yeah. I just want, Sushant, I know you're going to be impatient with the description that we are in an emergency, but I think for a lot of young people who, by the way, also led the forefront of the resistance on the streets against the citizenship legislation, if you remember that, right? And I think it was at that time so difficult for the government to act because young people have a certain moral force, just like farmers have a certain moral force. And which is why, wouldn't it suit the government to focus on the dimensions of this? And I'm not saying those dimensions are untrue, Sushant. Like I said, Deep Sidhu was exposed to this platform by me. So I'm not saying I'm not saying those dimensions don't exist. I'm saying those dimensions are not the whole story, but it would suit the government to focus only on those dimensions.
Look, I don't think we need to be hysterical about where India is going. These kind of things have happened forever in this country, and not just during emergency, even post that. And I can, again, and I think Tavleen Singh is sitting out here, perhaps she can expound upon the number of times there have been clamped down on freedom of speech, expression. People have been put into jail because the ruling party of the time did not like them, or you criticize the ruling family. So look, let's face it. This shit has been happening all along. So don't pretend as though this is something new and this is something which is happening a lot more now and it has not happened in the past. Perhaps people who were not affected in the past have started being affecting now because, you know, they are out of the loop. So maybe that is why there is so much of a song and dance about it. That's point number one. Point number two, look, as far as, you know, things like the farmers' movement and the moral force which you talk about, there is no moral force here. Come on. This is purely a bunch of farmers, especially in Punjab, Haryana, who were, you know, having a great time on government subsidies. And those subsidies might be being weaned off, who are, you know, fearful about their future. And they have a right to be fearful about their future. They think that the world as they have known it for the last 50, 60 years is likely to change. Now to pretend as though, you know, somebody's trying to kill the farming sector, trying to massacre the, you know, farmers, there's going to be a farmer genocide, which was incidentally one of these trends which was running, which was utter nonsense.
No, and it was a nonsense trend. By the way, I just want to say that I thought that hashtag using genocide was utter nonsense, right?
Exactly.
So it's not, so, but people, I'm just saying there are many
things
some of us see all of it.
Markha, why I say people are getting hysterical is because they use words like genocide so loosely and so frivolously that the word actually starts losing
that
its meaning.
That is true, but so is the word anti-national used as loosely.
Actually, listen, yaar,
and it is losing its meaning.
Markha, just because you and I disagree on something, you know, you might, for example, I have a certain approach on Pakistan. Your approach might be different from mine. That does not mean you're a traitor, okay? It does not mean you're a traitor. It means that you want to explore something else, and I might think that you're
I'm not even sure that our approaches are different, by the way. But
one second. Yeah. I'm just using you as a metaphor. I might think that you are taking a certain path, you are being foolish about it because we've done it time and time again. I can have a difference of opinion with you. I will not call you anti-national, or I will not call you, you know, a traitor, or you know, doing treason because you are doing this. Number three. And I think it's important that the way, you know, sedition was a very, very serious charge. If you are going to use a charge like sedition, please put in certain checks and balances so that it is not used by any guy on the street who gets up and files a FIR against somebody else. That is like crazy. You know, you can't do something like that. So perhaps some checks and balances. I'm not saying remove the clause of sedition. I think it's a clause which probably, a law which probably needs to be there. But clearly the way it has been misused, you probably need certain checks and balances in place before you can apply it to somebody just because you don't like somebody's face.
Also, in the internet age, you can say anything about anybody and then keep making it viral, right? Mr. Kumar, very briefly, 15 seconds, and I want to give Tavleen Singh the last word. Do you think this is a fit case for sedition?
See, my personal opinion is, of course, my personal opinion. I don't think so. I don't think so. It will amount to sedition. But, well, it depends upon the overall set of circumstances, what evidence they have collected, how they have interpreted it, and so on and so forth. But prima facie, I agree with Sushant that perhaps sedition is a bit too much. And look, there has been a lot of debate on sedition right from the time of Mahatma Gandhi, who said this is the first law that should be taken off the statute, to umpteen times that the sedition law has been called into question. And people have even gone to the extent of saying that this section 124A should be removed from the Indian Penal Code. So that debate can go on forever. But right now, it is a bit too stringent.
Okay. I have to close. Tavleen, last word to you.
Sushant accused me of being very selective in my criticism of things, and said that Kangana Ranaut has been charged with sedition. If she has, that is wrong. I believe the sedition law should be scrapped. It should have been scrapped when the colonial rulers of India left. And, that's true. What I do agree with you is that this government is playing from a Congress Party playbook that has been in existence since 1947. It's just another kind of people that is being, put into thing. But I will also say that this is the most powerful prime minister I have seen in 40 years of political journalism. And he needs to get a thicker skin. He cannot behave as if Greta Thunberg can destroy India, because that makes India look weak and ridiculous.
Sushant, briefly, and I'll let Tavleen respond to you.
A one-finger intervention on what Tavleen said, and she couldn't have been more right, because frankly speaking, every policy of this government is actually a Congress policy. So the Congress party should be actually very happy with this government for bringing in farm laws, which was a Congress policy, for bringing in Aadhaar, which was a Congress policy, for bringing in a whole lot of other things which were Congress policies. So yes, in a manner of speaking, that's the Congress playbook. Only Mr. Modi has taken that playbook and he's implementing it. So I don't think anybody should really have a problem with that.
Okay, Tavleen, let's return our focus to Disha, 22-year-old, accused of disaffection against the Indian state.
It is wrong, wrong, and wrong in capital letters. It is wrong to have done what they did. She should be released immediately. She can be questioned at home. To drag her off, right, to Delhi, for what? And secondly, when we talked about the magistrate, don't forget this is the Delhi police. The Delhi police is controlled by the Home Minister of India. Which little magistrate sitting in a provincial city is going to defy the Home Minister?
All right, we leave you all with that question. We will continue to report this story. We thank Tavleen Singh, Shreya Singhal, Jasmeen Patheja, Neeraj Kumar, Sushant Sareen, and Yuvan, whom we lost the connection to, Disha's friend, for joining us, and to our audience. This has been a long broadcast, but an important one. Thank you, and we'll have more on this story tomorrow. Thank you for watching. Goodbye. It's great to see you here.
Thank you for watching.
If you haven't subscribed yet, don't forget to click the bell icon and subscribe to Mojo Story and support independent, robust journalists.